The very essence of Miss Lauryn Hill lies in her personal jurisdiction. She never intended to make music for the masses, nor did she ever feel the need to succumb to modern materialist ideologies. As a black woman in hip-hop, Hill's greatest path to freedom was through her own mind, body, and soul. Hill's connection with these human characteristics, along with her fearless individuality, created this alluring personality that simultaneously intrigued music fans while inspiring others to renounce the industry standard. The Miseducation of Lauryn Hill is a rebellious album without ever feeling the need to sound rebellious. And what I mean by that is Hill's intention as a newly minted solo artist was to sing and rap from the heart and report what personally inspired her, whether it be motherhood, love's harrowing complexities, or spiritual kinship. And think about it, at the time of its release in 1998, hip-hop was on the verge of another identity change. Outkast was on a sharp rise, Biggie and Tupac were dead, Slim Shady hadn't fully materialized quite yet, and Daniel Dumile was still contextualizing the loss of his brother Sub Rock. Outside of these realities, rap in 1998 was finally a commercially viable entity, particularly within the context of gangster culture. The shiny suits were fine, but there was room for expansion, and Hill was one of those people leading the next charge. Hill's solo masterpiece broadened the dimensions of hip-hop by incorporating funk, soul, reggae, and gospel. The genre-defying mix came courtesy of New Art Collective, which included Varda Nobles, Rasheem Pugh, and brothers Johari and Tejimol Newton. Together, they created the perfect, spacious contour for Hill to approach each topic with a wider lens. The rapper-singer, who also produced the majority of the album, would later get in legal trouble with New York over creative control. Lauryn would eventually settle the lawsuit by paying them a large sum of money years later. There's a great Los Angeles Times article that explains what happened if you want to check that out. But for this video in particular, let's explore the intricacies of the Miseducation of Lauryn Hill, as it is surely one of the most ambitious, inspirational, and dynamic projects in modern history. The intro track of the Miseducation of Lauryn Hill fittingly begins inside of a classroom setting. A teacher who we later find out to be New Jersey poet and politician Raz Baraka takes attendance as if it were the start of a class period. When he arrives at Lauryn's name, the artist doesn't answer, alluding to her absence from class. The track trails off as Baraka repeats Lauryn's name to still no answer.
Tyron Lewis.
Here.
Tamia Caldwell.
Here.
Tamika Marshall.
Here.
Lauryn Hill. Lauryn Hill. Lauryn Hill.
It's a vague introduction to the overall narrative of the entire album. We later find out that this classroom will be the primary framing device that drives the story forward. The first official track of the album finds Lauryn illustrating a thorough explanation of why the Fugees ended up parting ways after their critically acclaimed album, The Score. Over a shape-shifting drum sequence with layered scratches, Lauryn begins her first verse with the lines, "It's funny how money changed a situation. Miscommunication led to complication."
It's funny how money changes situation. Miscommunication lead to complication. My emancipation don't fit your equation. I was on the humble, you on every station.
This, in a nutshell, represents Lauryn's ability to turn personal conflict into a universal feeling. The complications she experienced with former boyfriend and bandmate Wyclef Jean are part of the reason why she wants to detach herself from success and the spotlight that comes with it. "My emancipation don't fit your equation" packs a heavy punch with its multifaceted symbolism. Labels typically owned by white executives have a tendency to exploit black art for monetary gain, so this line could act as a clapback to that traditional construct. The line could also be in reference to her relationship with Wyclef and the many complexities that came with it. The tension mainly stems from a paternity test that caused strife among the two lovers. We'll get into that in a couple of songs. Overall, Lost Ones was the perfect reintroduction to Lauryn's enlightened mentality. Her experience as a veteran MC shines through, and her capability of gliding over musically rich production was exemplified through seamless sing-rap transitions. As someone who had already navigated the industry's walls for 5+ years, Lauryn learned about the darker side of material prosperity and wanted to expose it for her own mental liberation. Wisdom is better than silver and gold wasn't just a lyric in the song, it was Lauryn's scripture for the entirety of her career. At the tail end of Lost Ones, we hear our teacher Baraka ask the class if they've heard any songs about love. The listener first gets a glimpse of what the classroom framing is all about to teach the kids about love. This is interesting to note because, again, think about it, Hill is theoretically not present within the class. While it's not clear why she chose this literary route, some have speculated possible reasons why. Writer Alex Chikolko believes that there is some relationship between the album cover, which shows Lauryn's face etched onto a school desk, and her lack of presence. Maybe Chikolko points out Lauryn is indeed present in class, just not mentally. As the conversations fade out, listeners enter into X Factor, which is one of Lauryn's most popular songs to date. Generally speaking, the track finds Hill expressing her relationship turmoil with Wyclef Jean, her former bandmate and boyfriend. People often speculate that their failed relationship led to the breakup of the Fugees, a hypothesis that most likely holds true considering the logistics. Beyond that though, the relationship forced Lauryn to break down relationships in their most basic of terms. The "tell me who I have to be to get some reciprocity" illustrates how love is a two-way street, not some silly game to be taken for granted. While the theme of this song is very personal to Lauryn, the broader undertones involving compatibility are what most listeners are drawn to. The swirling production is as dynamic and vast as Lauryn's intelligence. It's one of those beats that never stays static. It's always in motion. It's the perfect reflection of Lauryn's colossal ideologies. It should be also noted that X Factor has been sampled in countless songs, most notably Drake's Nice For What. Lauryn even hopped on a remix of this track after it came out. Over demonstrative strums from one of my personal heroes, Carlos Santana, and a reggae-style beat that is as calm as it is meditative, Lauryn Hill proclaims her allegiance to, at the time, was a newborn baby Zion. As someone who always searches for spiritual guidance, To Zion is one of those moments on the album where Lauryn seems to have found some semblance of that. Beset from all the drama involving the newborn, many did not know if it belonged to Wyclef or her new boyfriend Rohan Marley, Lauryn wanted to create something that was unadulterated, something that was free from harm or spectacle.
Look at your career, they say, Lauryn, baby, use your head. But instead, I chose to use my heart.
Underneath the joy of having this newborn baby, Lauryn also comes to terms with a battle that many women in society face, a battle that shouldn't be as stressful as it is. The idea that women must choose between their passion and their family life, look at your career, they said, Lauryn, baby, use your head, Lauryn sings, examining the industry's pressures of being a black mother. In a way, she intertwines family and career, erasing any battle or negative perception that was thrown her way at the time. There's also a moment in the second verse where Lauryn proclaims that she's never seen a love like this before, which insinuates that Zion is the first time where Lauryn truly binds herself to someone unconditionally. The innocence of a child inherently gives us another reason to live, which is a feeling Lauryn wanted to exude on this track. Zion, which is also a biblical reference to the royal capital of Jerusalem, is almost deified by the end of the song. The end of To Zion features another classroom scene. In this skit, the teacher-tutor asks the students the meaning of love. One of the girls talks about how most guys will try to act cool in front of their friends when they are around their girl. This answer represents the broader theme of masculinity and how society almost forces men to suppress their feelings from manhood. This concept is once again brought up later. The skit leads on to Doo Wop, arguably one of Lauryn's most well-known songs to date. In fact, I think it was on the soundtrack of an NBA 2K game, but don't quote me on that. The track which netted Lauryn 2 Grammys ironically finds the rapper/singer educating the masses on the shallowness of some relationships. More importantly, she uses historical imagery to dethrone misogyny, begging both parts of a relationship to find some type of respect for one another.
In the club, I cool the cans. Don't care who they you fan, Papa Yang.
You got yeah.
Let's stop pretend. The one pack pissed out by the waist, man. Crissed out by the casement. Still the name of this basement. The pretty face man claiming that they did a bit, man. Need to take care of their three.
She encourages women to be themselves in the first verse. Respect is just the minimum. And lectures men about their materialistic ideologies. The second verse is dedicated to the men more concerned with his rims and his Tims than his women. Calls back to the idea of toxic masculinity, and the idea that men tend to mask their true feelings with materialistic gains. From this perspective, the skit at the end of To Zion, where the teacher jokes about boys showing more love for their cars than their significant others, is the perfect lead onto doo-wop. The acid piano keys and the theatrical horn section may be catchy, but it surely doesn't take away from Lauryn's astute grasp on human nature. The song ends with another classroom skit, which basically wraps up the complex themes of love described over the course of the last three songs. The girls are once again the ones expressing their true thoughts on love. One girl even has a heartwarming breakdown about what the difference is between loving someone and being in love with someone. Her judgment on the topic not only mirrors Lauryn's sentiments, but also represents the idea that women in society are more likely to offer a more thoughtful prose on the sophisticated motif. On Superstar, Lauryn shifts her focus on the industry itself, taking aim at the commercialization of hip-hop. Over a more reggae-style beat, Lauryn suggests that music released during that specific period was void of passion or genuine sentimentality. If anything, this track runs parallel to the love songs Lauryn drummed up earlier in the album. And if doo-wop found Lauryn expanding on the shallowness of some unnatural relationships, then Superstar was a courageous clapback at the shallowness of industry moguls, those who are only in it for the money. And at one point Lauryn raps, "Just as Christ was a superstar, you stupid star. They hail you and nail you, no matter who you are." This bar is most likely referring to the industry's tendency to sign artists they pretend to love, basically in an attempt to make more profits for themselves and the executives, rather than the artist. In this vein, Lauryn questions the cost of fame. Earlier in the song, she sings about the meaning of applause and outside approval, wondering if it all even matters at the end of the day.
Come on, baby, light my fire.
Come on.
Everything you drop is so tired.
The chorus meanwhile begs the shallow artists to light up Lauryn's fire, or make music that actually inspires. Lauryn's tendency to make bold yet subtle statements such as these are partially what made her stand out among the depreciative market. Her spiritual connections are what drives her art. Now she wants to know what actually drives others. Final Hour finds Lauryn in a more traditional hip-hop pocket. She utilizes tongue-twisting verbiage to enhance her own image, while simultaneously calling other crews microscopic. While the drum pattern is very reminiscent of East Coast boom bap, the instrumental as a whole is one of the more dynamic on the entire album. Every once in a while, you'll hear the flutter of a flugelhorn or the buzzing thrill of a trumpet. Final Hour is one of those tracks where the instrumental from point A to point B is never predictable. Lyrically, Lauryn continues the theme of spirituality. In the chorus, for example, where she says, "You can get the money, you can get the power, but keep your eyes on the final hour," Lauryn once again establishes the importance of loving yourself over materialistic gains, because at the end of the day, you can't take those possessions into heaven. Her lyrical imagery straddles the line between reality and life beyond existence, using religious phrases to drop knowledge on those who simply just don't understand. And I remain calm reading the 73rd Psalm, because with all that's going on, I got the world in my palm, she raps at one point. With this vignette, Lauryn seems to insinuate that all the information she needs is at the tip of her fingers, whether from a Bible or something else. For when it hurts so bad, Lauryn repurposed the theme from X Factor, the idea that love for her significant other wasn't being reciprocated. This song, however, is arguably more somber, as Lauryn's voice exudes more pain than any other song up to this point. This chorus is more a feeling than a hook, and while most interpret the track as Lauryn trying to find hope in a relationship gone awry, I mainly see it as just a solemn recollection. There are certain points, of course, when Lauryn quite honestly sounds helpless, proclaiming how much she cried, but just couldn't make things right with her significant other. There are even some moments in each verse where Lauryn is audibly distant from the mix, almost as if she's actually lowering her eyes to sob. Lauryn's voice quivers as she sings, "See, I thought this feeling, it was all that I had, but how could this be love and make me feel so bad?" This passage in particular is unique compared to the rest of the album, as the rapper slash singer appears more confused than ever before. Why, after all the energy that she exerted in this relationship, did her heart end up being broken? When It Hurts So Bad is one of the few times where Lauryn doesn't show as much emotional clarity as she usually does. The confusion shown in When It Hurts So Bad is personified in the classroom skit at the end, where a boy student explicitly states his confusion with love, as he used to have feelings for a girl but now doesn't for whatever reason. The teacher then asks if maybe TV and music are the reasons for why love is confusing. Entertainment can teach us one thing, but someone else's reality may not represent ours. One thing to note is after the boy expresses his confusion, the class starts laughing. This inherently reinforces the narrative where society expects boys to keep their feelings concealed. Even the children in this skit find it odd that a boy would be offering this perspective on love. Sampling Ice Cream by Raekwon, the R&B powerhouse duet I Used to Love Him features Mary J. Blige and Lauryn in a less confused state. "Father, you saved me and showed me that life was much more than being some foolish man's wife," sings Lauryn, once again showing listeners how much God has gotten her out of the incessant darkness she experienced. The song is quite honestly a brief moment of catharsis for both artists. Blige presents a more cynical side of love, mistaking the powerful feeling for a drug that basically took away her powers as a queen. Mary J. also finds true happiness outside of love, mainly thanks to her mother's familial guidance.
Some foolish man's wife showed me.
Overall, it's interesting to see two powerhouses offer their own personal takes on passion and pain. In verse 2 and 3, both musicians search and eventually find clarity for what love should really represent. "Showed me that love is respect and devotion," Blige sings, referring to God's power in finding light. The chorus, "I used to love him, but now I don't," essentially puts the nail in the coffin with regards to Lauryn's relationship with Wyclef. This is her moment of moving on, thereby embracing God's light before anything else. On "Forgive Them, Father," Lauryn fully accepts the notion that God will be the only one to judge her. To me, this is one of Lauryn's most impressive tracks of all time, mainly because of her seamless intersection of religion, spirituality, and historical metaphors. The song, more than any other on the album, is infused with Jamaican culture. On top of being a different rendition of Bob Marley's Concrete Jungle, Forgive Them Father also features Marley's son Julian on guitar and Jamaican dancehall artist Shelly Thunder on vocals. The song itself was also recorded at Tuff Gong Studios in Jamaica.
Baby,
Lauryn sings and raps like a grizzled veteran on this track, warning others to beware of false affection or appreciation. At one point she sings, "A friend once said, and I've found to be true, that everyday people, they lie to God too. It's one thing, according to Lauryn, for a person to lie to others or even themselves, but to lie to God is a whole other form of sin." Hill, however, takes the high road in the situation, even begging God to forgive people who are naive or unaware of their harm. There's also the topic of power dynamics and how people, men especially, usually try to chew on something more than they can handle. Why every Indian wanna be the chief, feed a man till he full and he still want beef, represents this idea that this senseless drive for power repels peace. The beef line is especially interesting because it could refer to the many rapper beefs, particularly between East Coast and West Coast, that occurred over the course of that decade. To Lauryn, power over oneself is what's most important, as well as fighting the racist system that allows for these power conventions. Why do black people always gotta be the one to settle? After a short classroom skit where a boy explains why he wants to keep the attention of a girl he loves, Lauryn transitions into a more nostalgic lane on Every Ghetto, Every City. For this track, the rapper/singer illustrates her most vivid picture at this point in the album. Feelings and emotions are transformed into the physical, as Lauryn ruminates on her memories riding mongooses and watching kung fu cartoons on Saturday while living in New Jersey. On top of that, Lauryn mentions the music that inspired her, from Slick Rick's storytelling to Biz Markie's amped up party anthems. She connects childhood recollection to places she visited as a famous artist. In the chorus, Lauryn even refers to her home as the New Jerusalem, once again utilizing that religious imagery that made her so famous in the first place.
Every ghetto, every city, and suburban place I've been, make me recall my days in the New Jerusalem. Story starts in Hooterville. Grew up next to Ivy Hill when kids were stealing quarter bills for fun.
What's intriguing about Every Ghetto, Every City is the fact that it almost functions as an origin story. Typically, one would find these types of songs at the beginnings of albums, but with Lauryn, she decided to add it close to the end. This track makes one assume that the album is not a linear journey, but rather an emotionally raw snapshot of someone who's toiling with her past and present narratives. She's a devoted being to balancing metaphysical with realism, while never taking her past for granted. The skit that precedes Nothing Even Matters finds a boy in the classroom explaining how the novel stages of falling in love affect him, where one hopes that the other has similar feelings. It's interesting how Lauryn ordered these skits and songs. It seems like at this point, Lauryn is offering a more tender perspective on the matter rather than the heartbroken or cynical one in the beginning. The album almost functions as a Tarantino movie in that way, where Lauryn places important narrative plots out of order. Now, what's more beautifully intriguing is the duet between Lauryn and R&B legend D'Angelo on Nothing Even Matters. In almost fairy tale-like fashion, both artists repeat the phrase "nothing even matters" as if the words were dreamscapes. Soaring piano keys swirl and flutter, while intermittent finger snaps add meat to this otherwise skeletal slow burner. D'Angelo and Lauryn capture those initial stages of falling in love, the ones that the boy was trying to explain in the skit prior.
Now the skies could fall, not even if my boss should call. The world it seems so very small, 'cause nothing even matters.
Not even my boss should call, Lauryn sings, meaning her only focus is the man she sees in front of her. D'Angelo reciprocates this feeling with his own heartfelt vignettes like, "Your love makes me feel like 10 feet tall." This song is a bold switch up for Lauryn, as much of the album found her steeped in realism and brief skepticism, and particularly with regards to love. This track is perfect because not only is it unpredictable, but it illustrates a warm dimension in Lauryn's dynamic personality. She vies for that picture-perfect love, but only with the person that understands her the best. Everything is Everything, meanwhile, urgently finds Lauryn back in her hip-hop pocket. She showcases her own unique wordplay through references of powerful women like ancient Egyptian goddesses and famous black nationalists such as Betty.
I begat this. Flipping in together on the dirty mattress. You can't match this. Rapper slash actress. More powerful than two Cleopatras. Bomb graffiti on the tomb of Nefertiti. MCs ain't ready to take it to the Serengeti. My rhymes is heavy like the mother sister Betty.
The flamboyant percussion makes it seem as if Lauryn is leading an army of youthful prophets, ready to differentiate truth from deception whenever and wherever necessary. She even uses this monarchical imagery, saying that she's too powerful than two Cleopatras, and how her type of hip-hop is more like scripture. There's also a welcoming nature to the way Lauryn approaches her boasts. She uses we multiple times when referring to chasing dreams, and sounds more optimistic about a fruitful future than ever before on the album. After winter must come spring, Lauryn sings, thereby foreshadowing a brighter future where the truth is the only path ahead. The title track for The Miseducation of Lauryn Hill is the ultimate breakthrough for Lauryn as not only an artist but a person. This is the exact moment when she finds accomplishment through her own destiny rather than trying to chase the dreams that others presented for her.
I hear so many cry for help, searching outside of themselves. Now I know that his strength is within me.
The breathtaking instrumental is the perfect orchestral backbone for Lauryn to approach her own achievements with gratitude. As mentioned in the beginning of this video, Lauryn's always been someone who attempts to connect mind, body, and spirit. On the title track, Lauryn does exactly this by searching for inspiration within herself. I hear so many cry for help, searching outside for themselves, now I know his strength is within me. Lauryn sings. In a special message, Lauryn said that the song is about growth and inspiration, and finding your dreams as you move from one chapter of your life to another. With that being said, this is the perfect song to present that message, because it basically sums up the themes of the album and what Lauryn was trying to accomplish all along, the idea of searching within yourself for pure happiness. Regarded as a bonus track of sorts, Lauryn recorded Can't Take My Eyes Off of You while reportedly lying on the floor. According to Gordon Williams, who was the engineer commissioner for the album, Lauryn recorded all of the song in one take, including the beatbox portions. She was also 8 months pregnant at the time too. The track is her own neo-soul and hip-hop version of Frankie Valli's 1967 smash hit of the same name. None of the lyrics are hampered, which means Lauryn most likely connects with the song on a personal level. It represents that first sight when falling in love. It's that exact feeling in its simplest forms. To be honest, it's the perfect breather after the heavy-themed project that preceded it.
Caught in the way that I stand, there's nothing else to compare. The sight of you leaves me weak. There are no words left to speak. But if you feel like
Tell Him, meanwhile, finds Lauryn finally securing that peace. While it's not specified who Him is, one can assume that Lauryn is referring to God. She makes multiple biblical references like, "Now I may have faith to make mountains fall." Another notable lyric on the song is, "Love is not boastful, love is not loud." The lyric, while simple on the surface, refers to the idea of intimacy, and I'm finding it can be rather difficult in the rap game when every part of fame appears blinding.
Let me be patient, let me be kind, make me unselfish without being blind.
The track is an interesting way of ending the album because Lauryn appears almost distant, telling us to tell God that she needs him and loves him. We can almost hear her fading away from the limelight, ready to make peace with the life she had at that moment. It's a powerful end to an illustrious album, the jaw-dropping cherry on top. It's crazy to think that outside of the MTV Unplugged she did years later, The Miseducation of Lauryn Hill lives as a one-and-done classic. It's even wilder to think that many albums have not made nearly as much of an impact as this one has 20 plus years later. The album not only left a sizable imprint in the industry at the time, but it also impacted many artists of this generation. Nicki Minaj was seen kneeling to Lauryn when she first meets her. Janelle Monáe said she bought 2 copies of the album when it first came out. Multiple artists have sampled songs from the album, including Drake and Cardi B. There's great music and there's timeless music. The Miseducation falls in the latter, mainly because of Lauryn's willingness to be honest with herself and others. In an industry that tried everything in their power to control black artists, and still do, Lauryn took the reins and drove to her desired destination. And for that reason alone, she still stands as one of the most iconic figures in hip-hop history.